where something red was the popular cry. And like the pavements and streets, they were filled with envy. Because by morning light, they were covered with our blood. I tell you, not one soul here escaped the frenzy. You know, sometimes you're gambling king, and wild is the joker. And sometimes the sight of the moon just riles up the lost, the hungry, the mad. These are the troubled times that we have down in Trinidad. Because under the crescent moon and above the bloody asphalt, strange dogs were barking deep in the night. Under the crescent moon, I'd say the drums were silent, but somehow the rhythm continued.
10 years have passed. For many, the events of July 27, 1990 endure only as a bad memory. Some people want to put it out of their minds altogether, clutching to the view that Trinidad Nice, Trinidad is a paradise, that in this party capital of the world, 1990 was nothing more than an ugly aberration. But is that really so? Do we really understand what took place that day? Have we learned anything from it? And very importantly, can it ever happen again? How could an armed group of insurgents waltz into Parliament and place the government under arrest? Was it a single spark that ignited the fire, or was it the culmination of a series of events that had festered for years? In this program, we will focus on some of the events leading up to 1990, the assault on Red House and on Television House, and try to take you as far as possible through the process of how the assault was planned and carried out.
The group, which would indelibly etch its name into the history of Trinidad and Tobago, was born in 1979. It came out of the Islamic Missionaries Guild, which was formed almost a decade earlier by the coming together of various Islamic groups at the time. This new group held fast to the fundamental tenets of Islam, but the basic ideology differed significantly from that of the other traditional groups at the time.
It's one of brotherhood, but we have not been working together, if that is what you're getting at. Over the years, they used to be a part of the United Islamic Organization, which is a coordinating body, and they have, for reason best known to themselves, they have withdrawn from that.
The African Muslims had difficulty in the early stages because the Indians were afraid that they were coming to get their monies and their daughters.
It was out of this separation that the first spark was lit some 20 years ago, which in the fullness of time would manifest itself into the events of July 27, 1990. A key factor, of course, was the occupation of these Mucurapo lands.
According to this document signed by the late Eugenio Moore, permanent secretary in the Ministry of Planning and Development, the land had been given by the state to the Islamic Missionaries Guild for the construction of an Islamic center. In the midst of this, a dispute arose over a grant of $20 million from a number of Middle Eastern countries for building the center. When the guild split, some members moved to Kelly Village in central Trinidad and set up a mosque. The Jamaat faction stayed at Mucurapo Road, and as the surviving members of the guild expected the money to go to them. However, trouble reared. The Jamaat went ahead building a mosque on the land, staking its claim in concrete. But a senior member of ASJA swore to an affidavit that the Jamaat was a splinter group. The matter went to court, and when Abu Bakr failed to put in an appearance, he was found in contempt and subsequently jailed for 21 days.
The Jamaat considered Bakr's jailing to be politically motivated and came to the view that the People's National Movement was an enemy of the Jamaat.
Despite the continuing legal problems over its occupation of the land, the Jamaat as a body continued to grow from strength to strength, increasingly assuming an activist role among the urban underprivileged youth. By the late 80s, its ranks were swelling with new recruits, most of them young and unemployed. Many drifted in from the streets, several had run-ins with the law. By this time, the Jamaat had developed Mucurapo into a thriving self-sufficient center of religious, social, and economic activity. Apart from the mosque, the site boasted a school, printery, library, boutique, garment factory, clinic, dormitory, and kitchen. But all was not well. Almost on a daily basis came reports of Jamaat members having run-ins with the police. A number were arrested. Around this time, December 1986, the National Alliance for Reconstruction had won the polls and faced the very unpopular task of implementing a structural adjustment program in the post-oil boom period. The austerity measures, along with the ULF split from the ruling party, fueled widespread discontent against the Robinson administration. And around 1987-88, with the tide of opinion rising against the NAR, the Jamaat joined a populist broad-based group known as the Summit of People's Organization, SOPO. The support for SOPO was wide and varied, with the group able to bring out thousands for a march to demonstrate its growing concerns with government policies. It was during this march that Jamaat leader Yasin Abubakar and several other members of the group were arrested. Indeed, it seemed this camaraderie and support within SOPO played a key role in fueling the Jamaat's belief that it would obtain public support in the 1990 uprising. Meanwhile, the Jamaat's power was growing on the blocks. Under what it called its drug eradication project, it dispatched gangs of between 8 and 10 men who would swoop down on drug blocks, sometimes assaulting drug pushers and seizing cocaine. But while the Jamaat claims its goal was the eradication of cocaine, law enforcement officials had a different view of what was taking place.
Their goal was to entrap these young, poor people, as they put it, into a life of crime. I no doubt in my mind about that.
The Jamaat insists that this was not so, even though they admit that they were armed and that some members were tempted.
But we had some brothers who were arrested and needed to be bailed. And some of the younger brothers were saying, you know, wow, we get all this cocaine, Imam, we could turn this over for you, you know, this, we could get this off your hand easy and make big money, you know. And the Imam called one of the television stations and had them witness us dumping the cocaine down the toilet. A couple of people left that day.
But the tensions were growing and exploded one day in 1989. The Jamaat drug squads moved on two drug blocks, one in Laventilla and one in St. Barb's. But police were waiting and a gunfight ensued. The Jamaatists claimed that there were connections between the officers involved and the drug dealers.
The situation was now seriously strained between the Jamaat and the authorities, with the Jamaat expressing open defiance against the police.
The situation prompted government to issue a strong statement. The police could handle its own affairs without vigilante interference. The authorities now saw the group as a serious threat. Just how serious a threat, however, they would not realize until much later.